Any parts of this broadcast that could be considered an electoral advertisement are authorised by Jamie Lee Ross, 309 Botany Road, Botany, Auckland, NZ.
The reality of it is that Agenda 21 Sustainable Development, it's in Auckland Council. It's in most councils across New Zealand. It affects every aspect of us right now. The government, in order to bring in full implementation, as Jacinda Ardern has committed us to, they need to control all the water infrastructure. That's one of the things doing that right now.
That's right.
They're trying to heavy all of the councils into surrendering control of water infrastructure, which is not democratic at all, because they're trying to destroy localism, which is part of the centralisation aspect of Agenda 21. It's all about controlling everything from a central point on a national basis, regional basis and global basis. And so these guys are marching to the tune very, very systematically in doing that.
Hi, this is Bruce Lipton, and you're listening to Planet FM.
Kia ora, greetings, and welcome to Planet FM 104.6. I'm Tim Lynch, and I trust that you are doing well. I invite you to stay with me over the next hour as we discuss and find ways to take care of our unique and magnificent green planet Earth. On the phone today, I have Billy T. Kahika, and he is a phenomenon in New Zealand here at the moment. He is a social media phenomenon and has come into being very, very quickly. So, kia ora, Billy, how are you?
Kia ora, Tim, and kia ora to all the listeners out there. It's a very busy morning I've had this morning, and after the great success of our national rally for freedom on Saturday. And I'm tired but elated and certainly energised by all the support that we're getting from almost every sector of society.
Excellent. Excellent. Billy, well, can I ask just quickly, Corin and your tamariki, your children, they're good too?
Yeah, they're all good. Thank you for asking, Tim. Yes, I've got an amazing wife that has allowed our very quiet life that we normally have to be completely shelved for the time being. And she hasn't had a husband now for a few months, and she's still behind me and she's supporting me and brushing me off when she needs to, and and just loving and supporting me, praise God. I mean, they say that behind every man that's leading is a great woman, and she's certainly that.
This is wonderful. Billy, can you please start off with a little karakia? As prayer is important as it supports clear good thought, correct statements and right action, can you just do a little 10-second, 15-second karakia?
Yeah. Yeah, I'd be very keen to do that, and I'll do a very brief one in Māori and then I'll translate into English. Ko te wiki te atua, me whakakorori atono ingawa, ingawa katoa. Ki e taumai te manakitanga, ki runga e te kingi, ai kraiti, pai maerere ki aia me tono whare, me te kaupapa, me te kōrero o tēnei wā. Father, we acknowledge you in all things. We thank you for your love and your care, and we just pray that as we talk today, that we would honour you, that you would honour us with warmth and your blessing upon our conversation. And we also pray that blessings would always be upon your house and the work that we do. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Thank you, Billy. Billy, your surname, Kahika, is a short for Kahikatea, this being the tallest native tree in New Zealand, even taller than our mighty kauri. Yeah, and these trees can grow up to 60 metres high and given time higher, so you come from a very important family tree, bro.
Oh, well, thank you for pointing that out. Yes, the Te Kahika name is quite an interesting one. It's got about three meanings attached to it, including, of course, being a part of Kahikatea. But Kahika and Te Kahika means that it's an expression of a warrior, expression of a leader. And so I've never really understood why I was born with a name like that, but it's certainly poking me in the eye at the moment. But again, you know, the movement that I found myself in front of is it's really about being the lead servant. It's not about being anyone that's hungry or lustful for power. As you know, Tim, you and I have spoken about it for some time. I've never had desires to be in Parliament, never have had desires to be a politician. It's always been, for me, getting on with my life, having my little business, being a musician, having a little ministry with my wife and helping people. And that's it, really. But this time, that we're living in now has required somebody to take a stand and air the concerns of many, many people that feel the same way I do about what we've seen in the behaviour of the government. And at the time I started sort of making live broadcasts and lectures about what was going on, there was nobody in the political landscape that was doing that, and that is why I felt compelled to make a stand, and not knowing that it would lead to the formation of New Zealand Public Party, and then, of course, into an umbrella group called Advance New Zealand, which I'm so humble yet proud to be a part of.
Yes, Billy, because many people throughout Aotearoa New Zealand, they're curious as to who you are, that out of seemingly nowhere you have built up a presence here in this country and overseas, and that you now have a large social media following as well. And without repeating a lot of detail that you have previously covered, because they can actually track back and see and listen to many of your or all your talks on Facebook, could you please, over the next so many minutes, 7 minutes maybe, tell listeners what compelled you to change your whole life around, enter as a public arena? I mean, you've done a wee bit already, and where very much the focus of your attention is, especially for those who have lost faith in the main political parties across our nation?
I think number one, let's take that first part of that statement there, Tim, is that I'm just an ordinary Kiwi, Māori, New Zealander. You know, I grew up in a state house in South Auckland with my beautiful Pākehā mum, Māori father, and, you know, had a very good life and never, you know, sort of wanted for anything but didn't have a lot either, you know. And so father of six, in love husband, two grandchildren. I'm about as fish and chips, meat and potatoes, everyday Kiwi as you can get. And one of the things that people have been really, really highly sceptical of is how does someone go from total obscurity virtually, other than my music career profile, into leading a movement that has a couple of million people tuning into us. And in such a short time, we've done basically what has never been done in New Zealand political history. And I think what it is, it's all about the message, the timing. It needed to be said. A lot of people were in distress, quietly thinking the same things, but didn't have an outlet for their concerns, for their thoughts, for their thinking. Some people would think they were going nuts looking at what they were seeing, and that it couldn't be what they were seeing, yet they were experiencing it, seeing it. And really, I came along and was able to, I guess, amalgamate and aggregate people from across society that share the same concerns, and I was able to put a voice to it and unite it all. And I think that's why the virality, the spread of the message has been so incredible, because it's a true people's message, it's a true people's movement. And, you know, the minor parties and the big parties, all political parties, absolutely hate us for that reason, because we are saying that there are concerns. And so in answer to your question, what made me sort of hit this topic or this whole movement and get it going was because, like everyone else, I've been concerned with watching New Zealand potentially losing its national sovereignty and independence for a long time. This is, to me, not a new topic. But when COVID-19 first came out and the government responded to it and developed a strategy based on the World Health Organization's information and the Centre for Disease Control and Prevention, I trusted it. I did. I thought the government may have had this right. My whānau and I, we locked down a week or so earlier than what was required, and we were wholly into it. But what happened was is that I started to see cracks in the narrative between the people and players that were meant to be on the same page, and that got me thinking, hey, hold on a second, if these guys know what's going on and they're meant to be team players and on the same page, why are there little cracks in the pavement? Why are there, you know, some contradiction coming up out of this page that they say they're all on? And so that led me to investigate all of the information and the narrative around COVID-19, because of course when they locked us down and started to then say that there is potential for people to be arrested and detained and face charges, that completely changed everything. And it was based on the narrative that we're dealing with a highly deadly disease. Now, we understand that if it was a highly lethal disease, everyone would happily be locked down. But what happened was early on is that I started to see other narratives coming from Stanford University and their epidemiology team headed by the wonderful Professor John Ioannidis. And he was saying right early on that governments around the world needed to relax. It's an overreach. Don't panic. It isn't going to be millions and millions of deaths. It's going to be something within the spectrum and range of the annual seasonal winter flu. That was also confirmed by Professor Simon Thornley from Auckland University and his epidemiology team. And so, and it just started to reverberate around the world that there were major, major, major concerns about the narrative. And then along with that, I've always been a studier and a watcher of the United Nations. I've been to the United Nations headquarters in New York. I've met Helen Clark at the UNDP when she was there. And I've been aware of the UN agenda for a long, long time. It's something I've studied for a while. I've studied the spiritual philosophy of the doctrine of United Nations. I've studied the socialism aspect of the United Nations. I have studied Agenda 21, Sustainable Development, and 2030, Agenda 2030, which are socialists, which are communitarianism and verity. And what I started to see when I was investigating COVID-19 and the government's response to it is that our Prime Minister Ardern had made a commitment last August at a Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation event in New York called Goalkeepers that she was committing New Zealand to full implementation of Agenda 2030. Now, that made me very, very concerned because when you understand about Agenda 21, Sustainable Development, Agenda 2030 is really the end state next evolution of Agenda 21 once that's fully implemented. And when you understand Agenda 21, it is an absolute terrifying example of totalitarianism and social manipulation, social construct and control, and to the point where everything to do with a human being's life, what we eat, what we breathe, what we drink, what we spend our money on, how we spend it, we do with our land, where we live, what we can build, how we can build, what we're allowed to build, permission to build, how we educate our children, medical sovereignty, health sovereignty, being able to be free to make decisions for you and your family. All of those are eradicated. Those freedoms are eradicated through Agenda 21, Sustainable Development. And there are plenty of lawyers and legal people in litigation right now against the UN's rollout for this. And because it is so terrifying and so all-invasive into countries around the world, and New Zealand is up to its eyeballs in it right now. So when Prime Minister Ardern said that, and then when I saw the government's response initially and had questions around it, I started to see a correlation between the goals of Agenda 21 and her commitment to it, and also the potential outcomes and consequences of their management style of COVID-19. So what I did is that I started making broadcasts and live broadcasts around and lectures around this, and it just went viral, Tim. It was unbelievable how many New Zealanders picked up, knew about what I was talking about, and just went, oh my gosh, at last someone's coming out in public and saying this for what it is. And these are lawyers, these are doctors, these are medical professionals, these are business owners, these are wealthy people, these are poor people, these are every member of society is awake and coming on board this. So we are reasonable, we are logical. Advanced New Zealand, we have policies dealing with everything that needs to happen and be dealt with from a policy point of view once we get into government, so that we can repair our economy, restore democracy in the right way, write a proper constitution, write a proper New Zealand Bill of Rights, repair our independence as a sovereign country, and repair personal, and no, not repair, that's the wrong word, but actually acknowledge personal sovereignty that we all have as a God-given right, get our housing under control, actually get housing underway in the right way, but take an entrepreneurial approach to it, not a bureaucratical one. Look at all the social and the economic problems and actually come up with real solutions by real New Zealanders, by everyday New Zealanders who aren't groomed politicians, who aren't groomed by corporates to toe the corporate line, who aren't groomed by the United Nations like Jacinda Ardern is, like Chris Hipkins is, like Grant Robertson is. You need real New Zealanders again into the House of Representatives that can really get our country moving again with the number eight Kiwi attitude again that's going to know how to fix things from a practical, real, tangible and safe perspective. But these guys that are in there right now are hostile to freedom, hostile to protecting our economy, and it's no longer that they can say that they're doing it based on medical science, because the medical science is now hugely against them.
Yes, well, one of the big things that I can't understand is that when our Prime Minister talked about Agenda 21 and Agenda 2030, she mentioned it there, but she's never mentioned it and said to New Zealand, let's have a nationwide discussion on this. Let's open up the debate, because most New Zealanders, and I'd say 80% of New Zealanders, 90% of them, don't know about these two agendas. So how could she say that overseas and yet not mention a thing here? And this is what you call transparency, or lack of it.
Yeah, there is no transparency, Tim. And when you stand on an international stage like that and you make such a commitment that is so deeply, deeply life-changing for Kiwis of every description, you've got to take it to the people. You cannot carte blanche make commitments like this on behalf of our country without taking an approach of transparency, educating people exactly what it means. And I'm not talking about having government people explain it. I'm talking about having independent people coming in to educate and really tell New Zealanders that if we go into full implementation, what does that look like? The reality of it is that Agenda 21 Sustainable Development, it's in Auckland Council. It's in most councils across New Zealand. It affects every aspect of us right now. The government, in order to bring in full implementation, as Jacinda Ardern has committed us to, they need to control all the water infrastructure. That's one of the things. And they're doing that right now.
That's right.
They're trying to heavy all of the councils into surrendering control of water infrastructure, which is not democratic at all, because they're trying to destroy localism, which is part of the centralisation aspect of Agenda 21. It's all about controlling everything from a central point on a national basis, regional basis and global basis. And so these guys are marching to the tune very, very systematically in doing that. But in order to bring in these agendas, Tim, is that they need to collapse our economy. They absolutely have to do that, because you cannot have a power base in the middle which can challenge the government economically. And currently, what we've had up until COVID-19 is a very strong, functional middle class in terms of economics. We've got, you know, obviously the SME sector is approximately 95% of our business and economic health. And in order to collapse all that, they've got to destroy it. And that's what they're doing without doubt. Without restraint, they are spending money to collapse the economy, to get us into such debt that we become reliant on overseas funding. And then, of course, you know, when businesses fall over, people lose jobs, we become reliant on the state. So it's a domino effect. It is about education and letting people know exactly what the plan is here. And this is not conspiracy. This is not conjecture. These programs are real. When they are interpreted properly, it becomes very, very clear what their agenda is in terms of controlling every aspect of a human's life to be free and to live without overreach and disturbance by government. All that goes in full implementation of this. And we've seen that the government, through COVID-19, through the creation and then introduction of the COVID-19 Public Health Response Bill, we can see that they're starting to build up a legal hedge around themselves to control every aspect of our lives. You know, the fact is that this government has said it's the only and single source of truth regards to the COVID-19 narrative. That we now had the police last week use their Facebook to say that same thing. The government is the only source of truth around COVID-19. But that's what Hitler said. That's what Stalin said. That's what Chinese communism said. It's what North Korea says today, that they are the only single source of all truth. And we need to wake up to that, because it's tyrannical.
Yeah, thank you very much. Now, with, again, freedom is also the greatest discipline we can have. When we have this freedom, we just can't go do everything. We have to actually be more mindful. But I'm just moving on now. Friday last week, the New Zealand Herald had an article saying that New Zealand has over $600 billion worth of debt out of less than 5 million people. I mean, this is astounding. How could we get into such a situation? Because what it means is that they're going to turn around and say, look, we've got to have to sell off Auckland ports, Auckland airport, blah, blah, blah. And that is how the so-called infiltration of people into the so-called business or government or local government councils are causing us to get more into debt, to the degree that in the end we'll just have to sell off all our, what few crown jewels we have. And this is a big problem.
Yeah, absolutely. So let's be fair on this. So I wasn't happy with John Key. I wasn't happy with the fact that he was selling New Zealand from underneath us and getting us into huge debt, which was basically had a lot to do with his post-GFC strategy to get us stable through massive debt. But before him, Helen Clark, she was doing interesting things. You know, it's not just this government. This has been happening since Norman Kirk died, really, is that we've had successive governments that take us down and down this financial rabbit hole and without any sort of tangible plan to stop the hemorrhaging of money and debt and then repay it back. But what we've seen with this government here is that they've super boosted that destruction of our economy through their socialist agenda. There's nothing clearer to me about that. They are socialists throughout. If you look at the definitions of the programs that they support, the doctrine, the philosophy that this government sits in, it's all socialist to the core. And so controlling populations through debt is a big part of the socialist strategy. It's been employed that way so that the individuals become reliant on the state and then the state becomes indebted. And then, of course, the other side to that comes with the use of fascism, which is the strength of the corporate side to be able to help socialists control the people, because they need the fascist side, which comes from the right, simply because that's the free market economy corporates that control money flow, they control food, harvest and production, medical, pharma, as you know, big pharma, all that. They need those companies to work with them in these private-public partnerships so they can end up fully implementing socialist agenda. So that's where you get the crossover between left and right and socialism, fascism. And so that's exactly what we're seeing here right now. You know, when you dig in and you start to look at who this government is talking to, who Jacinda Ardern's friends are and connections, then you start to lay this all up into what I call a map of actors and players and the chain of evidences and events, then you start to see that there are some very, very serious questions that need to be asked. The debt that we have, that we know of, is actually over $600 billion. We pay $45 billion a year, thereabouts, on interest alone without even touching the principal. And these guys have signed us up for $240 billion worth of debt out of COVID-19 with no idea how they're going to pay it back. Let's remember that when they turned up at the budget with $50 billion that they had to spend, they didn't know what to do with $20 billion of it. And that's an indictment. That's an absolute indictment on this government. It says that they don't know what they're doing. And you're right in terms of left and right. You know, it doesn't matter whether people vote left or right, because behind the scenes, the same agenda is being pushed both through Labor and through National. The thing is that Labor will do things much quicker and much more open aggression, and whereas National will take their time to bring the programs in, and they do it with a little bit more covert style. But Labor are very, very hostile. They're very aggressive, and make no bones about it, they don't like Advance New Zealand.
Yes, very aware of that. Now, we hear the word, you know, progressive. Well, it's progressive and then it's incremental and then it's gradualism and then it's creep. But now the pace is really starting to sharpen up, isn't it?
Absolutely. We've seen this government desperately marching towards an agenda, and they're doing everything they can to try and really ramp things up. If you look at the internet censorship bill that Tracy Martin, NZ First MP, has brought to the table, that will control everything online that they define objectionable, they can get removed, and they've got punitive measures in place to force on individuals and businesses if you don't agree with it and don't comply. They've got the hate speech bill where they can apply the same definition standards, which are very, very broad. And again, to be sensible, I'm not talking about the obvious stuff and not allowing that online. We don't want to see, you know, objectionable material, you know, showing terrorism or pornography or anything like that stuff. That stuff, we need to take a step against that. But they define things so broadly and can defy them in any way they can. That's where the concerns are, and the civil liberties groups need to absolutely stand up and be yelling from the rafters that this is wrong. But they are ramping it up quickly. They are trying to spend money as quickly as they can. Everything. They're bribing the Māori vote. They're trying to bribe iwi and marae.
Yes.
By dealing out grants as quickly as they can. And so we've got a campaign to try and educate our whānau i roto o te ao Māori and within the Māori world, with the Māori worldview, to wake them up to what we're dealing with here. And they are really ramping up efforts. They don't like people have an effect-based narrative that's different to their own, and they are out to, as Chris Ipkin said the other day, he said that they cannot rule out that there'll be punitive measures taken against people who spread lies and misinformation about COVID-19. Well, I'm sorry, Chris Ipkins. The government are the ones that are spreading the lies and the fear and the disinformation, and we will be holding them accountable shortly.
Yes, again, right on it. Now, I'm going to jump across at a moment. Robert F. Kennedy Jr. was in Berlin on the 28th of August of this year, and he is basically saying so much what you're saying now. It was probably the most powerful video or presentation that I have seen maybe in 15, 20 years. And Robert Kennedy was told by his father when he was a child, he said that people in authority lie, and if we live in a democracy, they will abuse power that we give them. He says the authorities will take our power. He says they like micromanaging us all. And he, in this video, hammers Bill Gates and Anthony Fauci. He mentions the Nuremberg Charter after the Second World War now being ignored. And he said, we are being orchestrated by a faceless machine. And I hear that Robert Kennedy is going to be interviewed by you soon.
That's right. So our dear friend, Dr. Richard Pitar, is arranging an interview, so like a group interview with the three of us, with Bobby Kennedy Jr. And that would be wonderful to that opportunity. I've got an interview tomorrow with Dr. Richard Pitar and Dale Beattree. And,
yes.
And so that's going to be good. And we've got a couple of other very exciting interviews on the table that we're working towards right now, which will blow people away. But definitely. Now, that's interesting, of course, that Bobby Kennedy takes this stance very clearly because he's a Democrat, and that sits on the left, as you know. And the Democrats must absolutely wonder what the heck he's doing, because he sounds like a righty more than a lefty. And of course, the left is where this government clearly sits as well. And when you look at our own political landscape here, you've got Judith Collins has pulled National back to the right a little bit more, but they were going to the left quickly, which is a bit of a giveaway. And you've got the Green Party, who are hugely left now, but more than they've ever been. They're more the environmental extension to Labor. And, of course, Labor is very much communistic in its approach that we can see today. So, yeah, very, very interesting times. Bobby Kennedy, I'm so looking forward to connecting with that man. And once we get rid of these lockdowns and once we get rid of this stupid approach to closing our borders, then I look forward to being able to meet him in person and meet some of these people that have become such great friends.
One of the peculiarities was that in Turkey, we don't hear much about Turkey per se. They've got a very, very strange prime minister. But Turkey decided when the COVID problem arose that all people from babies all the way through to 20-year-olds stayed at home, and all 60-year-olds and older stayed home as well, and they sent back the rest of the country to work. And what happened is that when you compare the results, the health results and the death results per head of population, it works out just the same as Switzerland. And Switzerland is a high-tech, very capable and clever country, and we find out that we in New Zealand could have actually had everybody working from 20 years of age until 60 years of age. However, we didn't take that route.
No, exactly. And if you look at the way that Sweden did it, now Sweden now is probably the penultimate example of proving that locks don't work and that keeping an open economy does. And what they've done is they've done an incredible job in keeping their economy buoyant, keeping their economy safe, keeping their people safe. I mean, they've had deaths. Yes, they've had deaths through COVID-19. But what they did was, under the leadership of Johan Gasek, just want to make sure I've said that right, and my apologies if I haven't, but Johan Gasek, who was Sweden's health, I guess, director general equivalent doctor on epidemiology, he said, right, we're not going to lock down Sweden. These are the steps that we're going to take. We're going to do our best to protect our at-risk and vulnerable parts of society. We're going to do that. We're going to impose protective measures there, and then we're going to keep our economy open. Well, hey presto, he has just been voted into his position as the chief advisor to Director General Tedros Adhanom of the WHO on the pandemic response. But why is that? Because he has successfully led his country into herd immunity. He realised very early on, he said, elimination will not work. this is a disease that is the same as a very bad, nasty winter flu, and we need to respond to it the same way that we do with other viruses of a similar kind. And so what's happened was Sweden still has their economy intact. They've gone through none of the stuff that we've gone through, and their people still feel like they've got freedom in life. But, of course, when he first came out with that, he was ostracized. He was called a radical, everything else, the controversial epidemiologist of Sweden. And now he's been employed by the WHO to be the head advisor to Tedros. Incredible.
Yeah it is. Now, can I just mention one thing? I've always noticed, particularly in this country, that no babies, no infants, no children, no teenagers, no 20-something or no 30-something has got COVID. And so there is a peculiarity, because you'd think that babies in particular, the immune system is, particularly in this sanitized world, has not been built up. You know, you get into the sandpit and eat sand and to build up your immunity and this sort of thing, you pick up stuff from all over the place. But I just wanted to throw that in. It's very peculiar that we've had this gigantic lockdown, and yet nobody's really mentioned the fact that the children have been able to come through as free as they have, with no deaths in this country. I am speaking with Billy T. Kahika of advancenz.org. Billy T. Kahika. And he is also the NZPP party leader. nzpublicparty.org.nz. nzpublicparty.org.nz. Billy, I want to be able to talk to you about some of the policies that you have with advancenz.org, because I think this is really important. A lot of people now really want to know what it is. So it's advancenz.org. Can you give a few of the real key policies so that people can grasp it, please?
Oh, absolutely. So immediately, what's really, really important is that we get functional democracy in place. So what we've seen over the last few months and what has been exposed to us is that there are no constitutional protections for ordinary New Zealand citizens. The New Zealand Bill of Rights can be overridden completely because it's got a Trojan horse section within the New Zealand Bill of Rights, Section 4, which basically means in the announcement of a national emergency that the New Zealand Bill of Rights is suspended. Well, that should never be the case. So we need to basically create a system that's going to guarantee protectionism to ordinary citizens of our country. And so our democracy policy, which people will see immediately on our website, will come up. That's really, we're very, very proud of it. It's a great policy, and it guarantees that we're going to rewrite the New Zealand Bill of Rights. We'll create a proper constitutional framework that enshrines he waka putanga and te tiriti o waitangi, and also guarantees sovereignty for people on an individual and a national basis, and that we will apply direct democracy, which is about taking the big decisions to the people and have the people vote on it. So people will be able to go in and download our policy and that. Attached to that immediately is our COVID-19 response policy. They'll be able to see that. We don't believe that. In fact, it's proven now that the government has done a complete hatchet job of handling the COVID-19 health crisis. They haven't adopted a new approach, which has been demanded of them by the science. They're refusing. They're defiant to it. So we do have a great policy around that people need to understand. It's also about restoring government integrity and bringing in those checks and balances within the democracy and the COVID-19 health response bill. We've got a doctrine and a policy that we're getting ready to announce around repairing the economy and business through our economic policy. We've got a policy around ensuring that public health and safety is a prime mandate. And what I mean by that is we need to be able to bring New Zealand to a point where the pharmaceutical corporates control health policy of a government. So we need to bring that back to equilibrium so that our whole stance on health and the medical sector is based on adequate funding, enough to ensure that St. John's doesn't have to be blooming fundraising every 5 minutes to keep going. That's absolutely disgusting that that's the case. That shouldn't happen. And I would say that, here's a little political dig, why did John Key give $13 million to the Clinton Foundation? Why did Jacinda Ardern give Hillary Clinton recently, I think it was $5.7 million of our money?
Agreed.
To an organisation that's been investigated by the US Justice and State Department. So what we want to do is invest in the right way into our health sector, make sure that doctors and nurses and emergency response teams are well and adequately funded, but also that natural health
Thank you.
As protect and recognised as being viable, as well as an alternative to synthetic and pharmaceutical corporate options. So we need to do that. We also want to protect the rights of the unborn. As a Christian, I'm dead against the abortion law that's in place now. I do recognise it is about people having choice. So what we want to do is that we want to take it to referendum and have people vote on it. I've heard from a lot of women that say they felt unheard, they were against it. So we want to take that back to the people. But along with that, we want to do a mass education campaign so that people really understand what this current law is about. And when people understand that and read it and are educated, like me, it'll break their hearts. It's disgusting. It's the worst thing I've ever read from a government, next to the government's COVID-19 response approach. So we need to look at that. We need to come up with a proper medical system that's based on real human health. We've got other things in there as well, housing and economic development through a proper housing development program, environmentalism and protection. We do want to get rid of 1080 yesterday and investigate who abused it and why and how it got into our system in the first place. And so there's heaps of stuff there. We care about the animals, even New Zealand, animal rights and welfare. We do. We believe that animals need to be protected.
Yes.
Because if you don't, you know, it's a funny thing, human nature. If we don't, the way that we are as humans and how we relate to each other is really important. But a good show of how society is how it treats our animals. So we need to do that. Around international relationships, we want to investigate any trade or treaty or agreement that we're currently in. And if they don't serve our interests, we'll get rid of them. So there's a whole bunch of stuff around investment guidelines and ethical investment behavior in our country and by our country or overseas. And just what people need to do is they need to go to advancenz.org. They'll see all our policies there. One of the things we're really big on, of course, is stopping Chinese Communist Party influence in our country and truly getting to a place where our country is independent and serving our people first and then being a good corporate citizen and a global citizen after that, but not at the expense of our national personal sovereignty. So that's just a quick snapshot there for you, Tim, and for the listeners. We are a very, very sensible, practical party. Yes, the COVID-19 thing is a huge issue that we need to tackle front on, but emanating out of that issue is just a long, long stream of issues that fall out of the bottom of it, that we have policies either ready to go now or about to be announced. So we're very proud of that. We're not just like the Outdoors Party, just singularly focused on just 5G and outdoors and 1080. We take those issues and we've got fantastic policies dealing with them. And it's not just about social credits, monetary reform. We have monetary reform in our economic purview. And so it's conservatism as well, protecting good things and decency in New Zealand. We've got all of those. So we're very much a broad-based party, and which astounds me that some of the little parties like Outdoors Party and Social Credit and aren't sort of flocking in behind this movement, because we want to get the same things into government that they stand on as well. But we are the leading independent party. We can't call ourselves a minor party anymore, Tim. We've got 61 candidates across New Zealand. We've got 7,000 members. We've got a couple of million people that tune into us. We are by far the number one social media and digital platform profile stars in the country out of all political parties, well ahead of Labour and National.
Yeah, I noticed.
And any of the others. So we are a real political party. And yes, the amazing thing is, brother, as you said earlier, how the heck did we do it in just 12 weeks?
This is true. Now, how many hits on Facebook have you had?
Oh, millions. Over 2.2 million now.
Yes.
And it increases every week because we see those figures all the time. I lose sight of them, to be honest with you, some because they are so very, very, very big. But what we want to do is, I'm just going to have a look for you right now and see where that sits, because what happens, the figures go up every day, and it's an amazing thing. So just as I'm talking to you,
very good.
Checking that out for you.
Excellent. Yeah, well, I've been locked out of Facebook at the moment, and boy, am I having difficulty with some of the... Oh, they don't like me either. Now,
just quickly, I'm just on the online at the moment looking at our social media site numbers. So what they do is they adjust them every couple of weeks. So now the range is from August the 16th to December the 12th. Last week it was, of course, you know, it goes back again. So right now we're at, since that time period, last week was 2.2 million thereabouts. This week it's 1.928, and we're just at the beginning of the week. So 1,928,823 people have been reached by message. On top of that, 1,795,236 people have actually engaged in our message. That's amazing.
Yes.
Absolutely amazing.
Yeah, it certainly is. Now, I want to go into a taboo subject.
Yep.
New Zealand's suicide rate. It's been gagged, hasn't it? Or something's going on.
Yeah, something's...
They're not telling the truth, from what I can gather, because there is so much, shall we say, fallout from this lockdown that so many people have given up because they've been locked away from society, working and talking and being with people, and we're not hearing the true numbers at all, from what I gather.
Well, it's interesting because the stuff.co.nz did an article last week, and they're using our poor mate Mike King to give them a bit of credibility, but there was a rise of 2.5% in July. So we've lost 685 people down in the year to July. That's 685 New Zealanders have committed suicide. I've heard from countless numbers of people that are distressed. Some of them want to commit suicide because they can't deal with it. They can't deal with the idea that their businesses are going, their marriages have ended, they've made mistakes because they've drunk too much and they've committed domestic violence, and that their marriages have ended as a result of it. People losing their businesses, and this is absolutely serious. What it shows us is that the, you know, when we consider we've had almost 2,000 cases of COVID-19 and 23 deaths, and yet we've had suicides go up in Northland throughout the lockdown. I believe we had around about 10 people commit suicide, 10 men over that duration, and that's just terrible. That's just horrible. In Te Tai Tokiro, where I live, we have like a major issue with we've got a major issue with suicide up our way. And what I believe is that this government has purposely not been honest enough about it. They're saying that they're wanting to set up a special task force called the Suicide Prevention Office as part of a national strategy. Now, why are they doing that? Why do they feel now that they need to set up a Suicide Prevention Office as part of a national strategy? Why is that? Well, it's because, number one, that they know that there is a massive issue with this emanating out of this crisis. They know it. They're trying to appear like they're doing something about it, but this is just a plaster on top of a gaping wound in our society, and I don't believe it's going to help much at all. They need to get rid of the root cause, because if they don't do that, then it's just going to keep going.
That it is. That it is, yes. But I just want to say that every time I sort of see you or hear you, you speak from the heart, your heart, and that's something that is really heard of. And why I say it really needs to be heard in our past and our harsh political environment. And so it's just wonderful. I just want to let you know that.
Thank you very much. Well, you know, I found myself a politician. I'm an ordinary New Zealander. I've never been groomed to do this. I know that I'd like to come across a bit more groomed in what I do in my speech and in the way I speak and all that. But I think the secret is that people know truth when it resonates towards them. And I think people can hear that in what I say. I think they hear it in my voice. I think they can hear that I am speaking from my heart. But as much as I am speaking from my heart, I have the facts and I have the basis to be able to put forward the argument in a controlled, in a calm, incredible, and factual way. And that's what's really, really important. In a truthful way, which is most important. Those are the most important things, really, that consume me in the way I speak. I'm debating Calvin Davis, John Tamihere, and other people next week for the Te Tai Tokiro seat on TV3. Yes, I'm the least experienced of those, but I'm planning to do a very, very strong job in my arguing. And also, I'll be debating the Prime Minister and Winston Peters in a couple of weeks, and David Seymour after that. And I very well and very much look forward to doing that, because they've got some answers they have to provide.
You bet. Very good. Now, New Zealand, we're essentially an agricultural country. And as you know, over years, I come from a farm, and Dad offered me the farm, and I turned it down. A farm in Matamata in the Waikato, a wonderful farm with a lovely stream running through it. And I declined it, and Dad said that farming was becoming far too scientific. That's what he said.
Yep.
And I remember there was a whole lot of stakes in a grid out in our paddock. And I asked Adel about these little stakes. I said, what's going on? And he said, oh, they're applying fertilizers and chemicals to the soil to see what grows best. And I thought, ah, so that's why it's science. So farming has become one of our backbones. And here on greenplanetfm.com, we've really been pushing regenerative or biological farming so that we actually really go back to the grassroots, for want of a better word. And your policy is also around allowing or helping the farmers get back to using less or no chemicals and fertilizers, but using minerals and also different seaweeds, etc., because the results are coming through. So I just wanted to pass that. This is one of your important policies too, is it not?
Absolutely. So we speak, and I speak to farmers all the time. I've got great respect for our agricultural sector, our primary sector players, that's for sure. And, you know, I've never met, as of yet, a farmer that does not want to be environmental. I haven't met one yet, and yet the green argument is that these people are state enemy number two after Advanced New Zealand, because you know, one of the intents, of course, within Agenda 21 is to control all aspects of food production, which would include milk, which includes beef and animal harvesting and production. So I've never met a farmer yet that does want to be environmental, and I think part of our strategy, if we're talking about getting rid of 1080, we need to look at all the herbicides and things that go into our biosphere, into our soil and water table. We need to work out immediately how we can replace those with cost-efficient, maybe government-subsidised alternatives, because it is really, really important that we do take care of those bacteria that we need. I mean, I remember years ago, people would talk about the Pukekohe area. I remember years ago hearing a story that you can't find a worm on Bunbury Hills.
Yes.
You know, and I'd like to know if that's true, and hopefully when we get to the government, I can ask that question and get some answers on that. But if that's true, then that's an indictment that shows you how lifeless our soil is, and it shows you also that whatever's going into our food that we're digesting isn't a good choice, because it's going to be questionable as to how herbicides and that respond to human biology.
Well,
and, you know.
Yes, this is right, because they're finding glyphosate in the Waitemata harbour here.
Yeah.
And it's because we just don't know it. As in Napa Valley in California, all the wines they've got there have got glyphosate in. And so we're really working against nature to the degree that there's so many autoimmune diseases now coming up. There's this comorbidity of all the different sicknesses. If you've got gut problems, if you've got skin problems, you can't sleep. This is all part of the response taken into all these chemicals in our food and the sanitization of water. And the fact is that our supermarkets, our main chains, still have an extremely small area for organic food. So essentially, New Zealanders are taking in food on trust when they realise now we have to be extremely alert.
Yeah, 100%. No, that is exactly correct. So what we need to do is immediately, you know, take a stance to investigate all these issues and find out how we can deal with them. But what I also want to do is set up an agency that's going to investigate how all of these things have happened to our country, because if there's criminal behaviour to be uncovered, we'll find it, and then what needs to happen is those people need to be held accountable. So just in closing, I'd really like to say what a wonderful pleasure and honour it has been to have this conversation with you today. I hope with all my heart that the listeners and the people that hear this interview will know that Advanced New Zealand is really an opportunity for the first time for a long, 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 long time, if at all, to have a political movement that is there to serve the people, that is intelligent, that is smart. We have soldiers, we have policemen, we have doctors and lawyers, everyone in our party that are going to be able to go into this government and change things to build a parliamentary and governmental system that will protect our people and serve the country, rather than trying to have the country and the people serve it. And I'd like to encourage everybody to go to our website, advancenz.org, and check out our policies, find out about us and who we are, and know that we are ordinary New Zealanders, ordinary people that care deeply. We're smart and the clever people in my party. I say that without any boasting, because I see the ideas, I see the candidates, I hear the concepts around how we can prepare our country, and I'm amazed by them. And again, thank you so much for having me, Tim, today. I appreciate it greatly.
This is lovely. Can I just drop in? You've got 1 minute?
Yes, I do.
Yeah. I'm really wanting us to have a whistleblower amnesty throughout New Zealand. You see, so that people can still keep their jobs and have their wage and salary protected, so they're not out of pocket, because so many people in all industries are gagged. They're not allowed to say things that are going on. There's so many different, there's, you know, so much corruption. But if we have a whistleblower amnesty that the government can get in behind and make sure, or we can have some super honest, shall we say, civic responsible leaders support, I think this is a big one. And also I'm wanting really having the children's future be factored into all legislation, that prior to voting on a bill, that the New Zealand Parliament has to state that all MPs that vote have to say that they have covered all contingencies that will prejudice the future health and freedom of children. And these, I've got a list of them, but I'll come back to you in another time.
Yep.
But these are really important, I feel.
No, absolutely. Hey, look, it's all about our children. It's all about our children and their futures. For me as a Christian, it's all about people being free enough to learn about what Jesus has done for every human on planet Earth. And what we need to do that, we need to have democracy. You see, freedom is what we're born with. Freedoms are what we're born with. Democracy is the protectorate of freedom so that they can be implemented in society through government. And that's what we've lost. And Advanced New Zealand stands for exactly that.
Thank you. Yeah, we are spiritual beings having an earth experience.
Yes, indeed.
Yeah, so, well, look, I want to come back to you sometime more. But I'll just do this. New Zealand used to be called God's Own back in the 1970s, and something's happened. We've lost that. And I think it's very important for us to remember that we have a special country, and we cannot allow it to be eroded away and, as you say, have our sovereignty taken from underneath our feet.
Absolutely. Thank you, Tim.
Yeah. So I want to say kia ora, Billy, to you and your family, and I trust that everything goes well coming up to the election and we see some new representatives in our parliament.
Absolutely, and I believe that's exactly what's going to happen, God willing.
Okay, Billy. Cheers, brother.
Thank you, brother. Thank you for having me. Have a great day, and God bless all listeners. Thank you.
Excellent. Thank you. Kia ora, everybody. This is Tim, and we're back in the saddle again. I'm still at the radio station. It's 8:24, been here since 10:30 this morning. And I've rung Billy because we've got a little gap that I want to fill. And Billy's had a full day, exceptionally full day. And so I'm wanting to ask, Billy, could you give us an update, please?
Yeah, absolutely. My pleasure to do that. Thanks again, Tim. Yeah, we've had an amazing day today. Just the amount of feedback that we're getting from supporters across New Zealand, people that were at the rally on Saturday. People know that Advanced New Zealand is really the only chance, really, for us to have a people's movement of that consists of real New Zealanders and good New Zealanders that will be able to get into government this election to create a system of parliament that will serve the people rather than have a system of government where the government demands the service of the people. It's the other way around at the moment, but we need to correct it and get it right. And people are picking up very quickly that we are the people's movement. We are the real option. It's not just Labour. It's not just National. It's Advanced New Zealand as a real option. We're not a one-trick pony in terms of our policies. We have everything ranging from education, housing, medical sovereignty, domestic and sovereignty, national sovereignty, international trade and relationships, economy. We've got it all, environment, government integrity. You know, we've just got everything sitting there, you know, and it's just amazing that a party that's 12 weeks old or so has that type of setup so quick. We've got 61 candidates across New Zealand. We have, you know, as I said earlier today, 7,000 members, and that's grown every day, and it's truly amazing. Our day today, we've been in the media throughout the day, people of course, the media is interesting, Tim, because mainstream media is really pushing the narrative of the government. And really, we can't really say that the government's narrative is mainstream anymore, because it's not. It's become fringe. Why do I say that? Because the WHO, the CDC, are the ones pushing out the mainstream medical information around the COVID-19 crisis. And now they're saying, from the mainstream, they're saying that lockdowns don't work, elimination doesn't work, won't work. The lethality of the disease is a lot lower than what we thought, in the range of the common flu. And so, you know, our government isn't speaking from that place anymore. It's speaking from a fringe where it's acting in defiance of this new information, refuses to adopt its behaviour and its management strategy of COVID-19. And it's all starting to become very, very clear that the media in New Zealand is very complicit and well-funded by the government to deliver consistently the government's narrative. But what's happening, while they're bashing us, while they're having a go at us, attacking us, people are starting to really, really be woken up that we're getting attacked for what? What are we being attacked for? Well, we're being attacked for asking questions that are logical, fair to ask, and are demanded to be asked because of the destruction that this government has caused New Zealand society, and I mean New Zealand society. And I got to say that I met a couple of interesting people in the fuel station on the road just three quarters of an hour ago, and we're talking about the economy. This is members of the public who recognise me. And everybody is just so scared and concerned about what's happening with the economy, the loss of jobs, the loss of businesses, the loss of livelihoods that everyday New Zealanders rely upon to live their lives and feed their children and pay their bills. So, you know, it's certainly out there now that these issues are mainstream. Nobody's talking about them other than Advanced New Zealand.
Excellent. Well, this is fantastic. I'm so glad to hear that. And Billy, look, we're now through this little time gap. Can we sing Te Aroha?
Oh, yes.
Okay.
Okay, I didn't expect that, but let's do one verse of it.
Okay.
Te aroha, te whakapuno, me te rangi mari e, tato e.
There you go.
Okay. Kia ora. Thank you, Billy.
My pleasure. Good night, everybody.
Night. Cheers, bro. Bye.
Bye-bye.
That was Billy Tikahika of advancenz.org. And also, Facebook, fb.com/New Zealand Public Party and newzealandpublicparty.org.nz. Decide to network. Use every letter you write, every conversation you have, every meeting you attend, every email you send. And remember, even Facebook. To tweet and to express your fundamental beliefs and dreams. Affirm to others the vision of the world you want. Network through thought. Network through action. Network through love. Network through the spirit. You are the center of a network. You are the center of the world. You are a free, immensely powerful source of life and goodness. Affirm it. Spread it. Radiate it. Think day and night about it, and you will see a miracle happen. The greatness of your own life in a world of big powers, media and monopolies. But of 7.8 billion individuals, networking is the new freedom, the new democracy, a new transparency, and a new form of wholeness and happiness. This originated by Dr. Robert Muller, Chancellor of the World Peace University, in Costa Rica, Central America. I invite you to be able to come to greenplanetfm.com, where we have over 500 interviews in our database, which you can readily download and listen to be able to inspire yourself to become the change you want to see in the world and become involved in caring for your children and grandchildren's future. We are also on Facebook, on Green Planet FM and ourplanet.org. Please come and love us. This is Tim Lynch in the spirit of Aroha, wishing you a wonderful week. We look forward to being with you next week. I say kia kaha and haere ura.